Milo, is that you?
There, I think I got it.
I'm going to hit the button right now.
Hit the button.
The red light has gone on outside the studio.
The on-air studio sign is on.
Yeah.
Auto went right.
And you know what's coming to my mind right now, Lionel will understand, is SCTV is on the air.
Yeah, exactly. And we're throwing a bunch of Craftsman.
TVs out the window.
Craftsman kits out.
A bunch of Craftsman magazines out the window. Yeah.
Well, what, you wouldn't throw them out the window.
You'd probably like frisbee them out the window, wouldn't you?
No, you'd throw it like kits, Craftsman kits.
Oh, Craftsman kits. Okay.
All right. Know, with the parts flying everywhere. And
sure. Yeah.
I can't tell if this is going to be like a whole show or a segment.
Right.
That's always kind of exciting when we have these. Go ahead.
I was going to say, can I ask a question before we go too much further?
Absolutely.
Free or Patreon?
Who knows?
Oh, okay. So this means you and I will be doing an intro later.
Actually, this will be on the free channel.
Okay.
I just don't know if it'll be part of a variety hour.
Right.
Or a standalone show.
It depends how exciting our guest is, or interesting our guest is.
Or how interesting you guys are and how many questions you have to ask him.
We can ask all the questions you want. It depends, will our guest be able to answer the plethora of questions that will be coming his way.
And when I say you guys, I refer to, of course, the lilting, the subtle lilting tones of Bruce, the moderately agitated mailboy.
That's me you're hearing right now in your left ear, or it could be your right ear. We're not sure which stereo channel is working here.
Well, I do this actually when it goes out, it's mono.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Yeah. Because the very first show I ever did was stereo because I didn't know it. I had no idea what I was doing.
Right.
And by the time we got to like the fifth or sixth show, I realized I could turn off stereo and it could just be mono. So every show that's gone out over the last 8+ years, pretty much every show that's gone out is in mono.
So we don't have 3D sound effects ripping through your left ear into your brain.
Exactly. Wow. Because the problem is with the recording software I have, even after 8 years and the new and improved recording software, the way it comes into the computer is when I talk, it's in one ear. And when you guys talk, it's in the other ear.
Oh, I see.
Which I find to be very unsettling.
Right.
And it's,
so which ear am I in right now?
You're in both ears.
You're in both because it's not recording.
No, because it's not stereo. It's mono.
Oh.
Yeah, stereo is different channels, right? The sound comes out in different channels. I would have thought you would have known that, Bruce. There's no way I could know more.
It's not quite quadraphonics, that short-lived wonderful thing.
There's no way.
Which has been surrounded by sound, surround sound. Now.
There's no way I could know more about audiophonics than you do, or stereo and all that stuff. There's no way.
Because all I know, Audacity is a great program for screwing around with audio stuff.
All I know is I learned how to get it so it's mono, so it just comes out both ears.
Perfect. Can I ask you another question?
Sure.
You can turn your camera off?
Sure. You don't like to?
You've left it on before and got the little miffed. Right? Well, you see what I'm doing?
Yeah exactly. I
Why
get
didn't
miffed.
You tell me? Well, we were getting entertained.
I get miffed.
Yes.
And I'm
moderately miffed.
I would say I'm easily miffed.
Easily miffed? Okay.
I would say so. I think I'm an easily miffed kind of guy. I have no problem admitting to that. It comes from my hockey years, I think.
Going into the corners and somebody gets the elbows up and you get miffed.
I get miffed. I would get miffed. I would say, hey, that hurt, buddy.
What about it? And you have a discussion.
And then there was, because this all happened in the early 70s, just before the famous Broad Street Bullies, having a Donnybrook was all part of, was an expected part of the game.
That's it.
Mm.
And I enjoyed it. I always say hitting a guy in the face is great. And you don't feel when he's hitting you in the face until sometime later. So at the actual time, exchanging blows and hitting him in the helmet and things like that, it seems like great fun until later, till your hands are throbbing and your head is throbbing. And
Yeah, you go, what was I thinking? now, back in the day, were you still wearing the Butch Goring type helmet?
We hadn't gotten.
Still Butch Goring, all right.
We hadn't gotten to that point. I actually started my hockey career not wearing a helmet. That's how early you got going. Yeah. And in the other seat, in the co-pilot seat, we have the modeler, simply known as Kelly.
Am I in the co-pilot or in the engineer seat?
Well, you're in the engineer seat. I always like to feel like I let the guest drive, you know?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
You know, it makes sure.
As all I know, I'm on the milk crates in the back. So
yeah, exactly. Yeah. You're in the milk crates in the back. Yeah, we're old technology. We still have a flight engineer.
If one of these engines fails, how far will the other one take us? All the way to the scene of the crash, which is pretty handy because that's where we're headed.
So tonight we're going to talk to our buddy Otto Vondrak.
Yay!
Yeah, and his father was Ed Vondrak.
But not that Ed Vondrak.
A different Ed Vondrak. A very good gentleman who was, I think he was in the furniture refinishing business, if I remember correctly. And anyways, we're going to talk to Otto about the 90th anniversary of Railroad Model Craftsman, which I think is really cool.
That is very cool.
Otto? Otto?
Oh, sorry, guys. I was finishing up in the green room. I like the new chocolate-flavored shrimp. Interesting addition.
Yeah, they're like, the chocolate dipped, yeah.
Yeah, you're the first one, so thumbs up or thumbs down?
Would not recommend.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, the chocolate.
Note to the catering staff, no more chocolate dipped
shrimp. Did you try the blue and gold shrimp?
You know, after the chocolate experience, that was enough for tonight. But thank you. Maybe next time.
This is actually on a Monday. So, Otto, did you know that this every Monday podcast on the Modeler's Life, on the AML Network, Modeler's Life, every Monday podcast is sponsored by Rapido Trains.
Well, that's excellent.
Yes, Rapido Trains, your fast track to model railroading fun.
Yeah, I think you could sell that a little better, Bruce.
Yeah.
Rapido Trains, your fast track to model railroading fun.
Yeah. It's going to be a bummer if it turns out they don't like that slogan we invented.
Yeah, well, that's true. we always have the option you throw the Queso Cowboys one in.
Yeah, we got the jingle now. We got a jingle from the Queso Cowboy. Yep. Yeah, so...
Could be N, could be HO, your fast track to fun with Rapido.
For quite some time now, officially I would say it started January 1st. We were practicing through the months of November and December 2022, and officially it started on January 1st of 2023. And I'm hoping by now, middle of February, that we've at least gotten to the point where we're semi-good at it. Because I feel I'm anal about wanting to make sure that Rapido Trains and Jason Schron get their money's worth.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So we're thrilled that Rapido Trains is our
fast track to model railroading fun.
Right. And is our sponsor. And you can find them at rapidotrains.com.
Indeed.
And you can be rest assured, Otto, this will not be the last time we speak of it during this show.
Yeah.
Well, I imagine Rapido also sponsors the 2-minute warning and the halftime show and the postgame show too, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
And the instant replays.
And the instant replay.
Yeah.
And the blue and gold shrimp.
Yeah. Yeah. Have you noticed? Did you notice that our studio is now blue and gold?
I do enjoy it. It's very nice.
Mm-hmm. One of the writers in the contract. Requirements. So what's the deal here, Otto? 90 years.
It's pretty exciting, actually. And it was actually one of the things I thought about when I took the editor's chair back in 2019. I've grown up my whole life. I've been a magazine nerd, for lack of a better word. You know, I grew up reading all the magazines, anything that I could get my hands on related to trains and model railroading, you know, I would read. And that included, magazines like Model Railroader and Trains, which I grew up reading. And then later on, you know, Railroad Model Craftsman and Rail Fan Magazine, you know, also picking up the odd issue of Model Railroad Ding and Rail Classics and whatever it was, whatever I could find, I was always getting my hands on. But what really impressed me was the longevity of all of our publications and how they all have a history and a legacy. And I started picking up back issues at like tag sales and flea markets and train shows. And you see that even like magazines with a long life have the same DNA and the same, you know, character, even if the modeling changes or the themes change over time. So when I became editor of Railroad Model Craftsman, I'm like, first of all, I was like, holy cow, I now have the same job that Tony Koester once held. And I grew up reading Tony Custer's columns, and now I have his job, and that's very meta and weird to me. You know, and you know, we've since got to know each other, and we've got a professional, we've got a good professional friendship, and it's just interesting to know him, you know, in that capacity now. But
hang on, Otto, I have to apologize. I went to hit the mic button so that nobody would hear me coughing.
Oh.
And I hit the camera button instead, so everybody heard me coughing. And we
saw you.
And you could see me coughing. Well, how do you think this show will be in another 8.5 years, Otto? Any chance it will be even remotely professional?
I think that there's a decent chance that, you know, I think you guys can at least play second that race to the bottom.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, so we might screw up the draft pick.
Okay. So yes. So you and Tony have gotten to know each other. That's kind of cool. That's very cool, actually.
And it's funny because since I've assumed the editor's role here, you know, we've talked about things, you know, things that he did when he was at the magazine, things he suggested he would like to see come back, and just trading all these ideas, but just all of that together, you know, I'm not trying to boast like, oh, I'm friends with Tony Koester. I'm just saying like what the overwhelming feeling is that RMC is not my magazine. I am merely the steward and the caretaker. I'm in charge of this legacy of 90 years. And it's my job to make sure that this magazine keeps moving forward.
Absolutely. That's a huge, it's a huge responsibility because I think, as I've said to you before, it's a pretty cool thing being a model railroader and being the editor of Railroad Model Craftsman. I mean, it's just, it's a legacy. It's a responsibility that, it's a very cool thing to be. Now, when you talk to Tony and it's cool for you to be friends with Tony, Do you guys ever like, does Tony go, hey, I bet you, is it cool to be friends with Lionel? Cause we're friends. And how do you like that?
Yes. Actually that comes up all the time. Yes. That's usually our first topic of conversation. Yes.
So how many years have you been editor now exactly?
Let's see, this is 2023 and I've been there since 2019. So I think that's 4 years now.
Wow. And, the magazine is so professional. So what is, in the 4 years you've been doing it and leading up to the 90th anniversary, which is very cool because I got a lot of cool questions about that, or at least I think they are. Have you noticed a change? Is there something about it that, is there something about being the editor of the magazine that 4 years later you're kind of going, geez, I really didn't expect that when I started, or kind of the whole responsibility of the thing, has it felt more important? Like what has shifted, what has changed in your mind as just general editorship kind of things? That was a good question when I started out and it kind of fell apart as we went along.
No, it's always good to fly the airplane while you're building it. That's and that's what I feel like every time I literally sit down at my computer and I'm working on the magazine. And you know, when I started, I mean, first of all, I've been working for the publishing company since 2011. And I've been involved with Railfan and I'd been tangentially involved with RMC for years before that, doing contract work. So I always had a pretty good feel, you know, for the tone of the magazine. And, you know, I always say that RMC, you know, our standout quality is that we speak with a different voice. That's what sets us apart. And I can't tell you exactly what that tone of voice is, but you'll know it when you read it. And things that changed when I came on board, you know, I took over from Stephen Priest. He went on to some other opportunities in the industry, and he laid down a pretty good foundation. The magazine needed a visual overhaul, to be sure, and he worked on that, gave it a fresh look. I came in and I just tweaked some things, just building on, because it was a good foundation, didn't need another overhaul just because I was coming in. But the one thing I looked at was, okay, what do I have to work with here? Well, we have some regular columnists. We're going to keep that the same. We've got a pretty good library of feature material to draw on. But even for my first issue, I went out and found, you know, some original stories that I wanted to get into the magazine right away. And then even within a couple of years, some of our regular columnists decided that they wanted to retire and do other things. So I had to find replacements for them, or I had to retool those columns into something else more inclusive. But the whole time, I think I was focused on, if there's going to be any changes, that they have to be evolutionary and not revolutionary. I think with a hobby with so much long history and with a magazine with so much long history, to just rip off the Band-Aid and force a lot of change on people right away, it can be jarring. As humans, we don't like change. And I think whatever we can do to introduce new ideas and concepts, I want to do that in a way that's approachable and relatable. We don't just want to change things for the sake of changing things.
Yeah, I think I've become kind of a history buff. Like, I think that's a really good point. The hobby has a lot of history now. It's not just, it didn't just start like 5 years ago. Like, you, when you jump in and you become the editor of the magazine, I guess that's what I was trying to say, is like, man, like, you, now you're in charge of it's a historic publication for this particular hobby. I mean, me personally, I think this hobby is way bigger than anybody realizes. But I think it's important that you embrace the history of what Railroad Model Craftsman is to the hobby.
Well, what I find interesting, so we're celebrating our 90th anniversary in 2023. This is coming out around mid February, so you guys should be seeing that special 90th anniversary issue in your mailboxes pretty soon. We expanded to 116 pages for this issue. Pretty excited about that.
Wow, nice.
Nice big fat collector's issue. That's exciting. But I've been doing a lot of research about our history because I feel like a lot of it's been lost. And if you look at our industry, and, you know, there's two magazines. There's us and there's Model Railroader. And Model Railroader's history is very easy to write. It's very linear. Founded 1934 by Al Kalmbach. His publishing company has produced it ever since. I'm not sure if any of his family is still on the board of Kalmbach Media, but it's a very straight line. It's other than editors and staff who come and go, Model River has been published by Kalmbach since 1934. Model Craftsman is not as easy to document. And unfortunately, a lot of our early history has just been lost to time. When I was doing research about our history, one of the things I noticed, first of all, people should know, we don't have an archive. A lot of times people will call me up, write me, and be like, hey, can you, you know, scan me the page 37 from the July 76 issue? I'm like, yeah, if I have it in my stacks. Otherwise, you know, you'll have to find it on eBay. A couple of things happened. Carstens had a big flood in 1980 that wiped out a lot of archival material.
Wow.
So a lot of stuff from before 1980 was lost. And just even before that, just having anything from our early days is just hard to find. I was very lucky. One of the items I found on eBay recently was a bound volume from volume 1, 1933.
Nice.
And I was able to get it for a decent price. Gold stamped name on the cover of this bound volume is E.P. Alexander.
Oh, nice.
Ed, I have Ed Alexander's personal copy of volume 1 of Model Craftsman.
How cool is that?
And for those of you who don't know, Ed Alexander was a pioneering O-scale manufacturer from the 1930s who was the magazine's Model Railroad editor, because when Model Craftsman started in 1933, it was a general Hobby and Home Crafts magazine. It included topics. Model railroading was in it from the start. There was always model railroading in every issue, but you're also going to find model boats, model race cars, home woodworking projects. You're going to find, because they were trying to appeal to a broad audience in the depths of the Great Depression. Again, so already see how complicated our history is. You know, so Ed Alexander was not the first editor. He was just the model railroad editor, helping the editor find content for the magazine. The editor was a technical author. His name was Emmanuel Steary. And he was a technical editor. He was a hired gun. You wanted a book or an article written, you hired him and he would churn it out for you. So the first issue of Model Craftsman hit the stands March 1933. That alone, if any of you are in printing and publishing, that should tell you something right there. The company wasn't founded in March 33, just like back in January, I was working on the March issue of Railroad Model Craftsman. We always work 3 months in the future, 2 to 3 months in the future. So you have to imagine that even though the first issue was dated March 33, they were probably working on it in January 33, and the publishing company was probably founded at the end of 1932. So that's our history right there. And I'm only backtracking about all that and all these technicalities because it's not a coincidence that Al Kalmbach started his magazine in 1934. Al Kalmbach was a trade printer. He had his own printing company, and he was a hobbyist. He was a model railroader. He was one of the, when you could measure the number of people who would call themselves a model railroader in less than, you know, maybe there was 1,000 or 2,000 people out there. So it wasn't a coincidence that Al Kalmbach a year later put his publication out in the market. But think about that: the roots of Model Craftsman probably go back to late 1932, with the first issues hitting the stands in March 33. To further confuse people, as I was doing more research, I found in the first few years during the summer months, they would just print a combined July-August issue. So even the first couple of years of Model Craftsman didn't get 12 full issues in a year. So again, this is part of this whole thing. Like as you start tugging on one thread over here, another one starts moving and you start connecting all the dots. But from the start, Railroad Model Craftsman has had model railroading content every month of publication since 1933.
Do we have any indication, and I'll put this out to the room, do we have any indication why Model Railroader and Railroad Model Craftsman started at basically the same time in the early 30s? Like, that seems odd when you stop to think about it.
And I thought about that too, and just based on my research and what I could glean from the time period. Also, 1932 and 1933 were probably the worst times ever to start a new business. Literally, 1933 was the worst year of the Great Depression, or it would turn out to be. Record unemployment, everything, a lot of things not going right.
I've heard about that.
And again, so what's interesting, here's an aside, my father passed away more than 20 years ago, but my dad was born in 1926. He grew up in the Great Depression. He could tell me stories, what it was like. I'm only one generation away from my dad. I was obviously born much later, but having that direct connection to my dad who was there and hearing his stories growing up in the Bronx and what it was like, you know, fortunately his family was able to put a living together, but a lot of people couldn't. And in America, we've painted this very romantic, like, oh, the Great Depression, we pulled each other up by our own bootstraps and we made do and we got closer as families. And yeah, and there was record homelessness and record unemployment and record a lot of not pleasant things happening. So in the depths of all of this, and I was reading in Emmanuel Steary's first editorial in the magazine, he says, you know what? We're launching this magazine because we're at an unprecedented time in America. We're hoping that we can reach all the uncounted American craftsmen in this country and teach them how to, you know, work with their own hands and maybe make a living or maybe, you know, make some ends meet. Or just really, if you read between the lines, kind of occupy yourself and take your mind off that things are really not going well right now. And that's really where the root came from. And there was no real organized model railroading hobby that would curiously come in 1935 with Al Kalmbach helping found the NMRA.
Yeah.
So think about it.
That's another thing.
Okay. Before that was, and I'm just thinking back to sort of the roots of the hobby over in Europe and UK, was there any, as far, and I don't know, was there any better organization on the other side of the ocean before it kind of coalesced over in North America?
Well, what I did find out, I didn't find any other organizations, and there may have been some local clubs that have just been lost to time. But if you think about it, Model Craftsman launches in 33, Model Railroader launches in 34. Between the two of them, drumming up enough interest in organizing the hobby, and right. Even early on, there's a separate club news column in both magazines because all of a sudden, model railroad clubs start springing up, or the ones that maybe existed before then are being recognized because now there's two national publications. So I think together, the two magazines are responsible directly for the formation of the NMRA and the organization of the hobby. But so we talk about MR and we talk about RMC. And I don't know why I'm talking about MR so much on my 90th anniversary.
Yeah. Well, you know what?
They're directly related.
Yeah. I'll tell you why. Because you're a man of integrity. Ever since I've known you, you haven't been somebody that's tried to pretend that Model Railroad didn't exist. You're a man of integrity. You're in the publishing industry. You happen to be in the Model Railroad publishing industry, and you recognize there is a major competitor for the magazine that each month you guys, you know, have to, you know, you're aware of each other.
That's absolutely. And I appreciate that. But like, and from a strictly business standpoint, that is the marketplace. There's two competing magazines vying for the audience. And that's really where the idea of competition ends. I'm friends with a lot of people over at Kalmbach. I know Eric White, new editor at MR, great guy. We've had some great conversations last couple of train shows we've been at together. I do want to put to rest any ideas that we fight with each other or we steal authors from one another. That's not the case. But I do want to make a point, and I don't like to toot my own horn often, but I do want to point out that we've been doing this a little longer and we were doing it first.
But there you go.
We were doing it first in America. To Bruce's question, part of RMC's history, there was a magazine founded in 1924 called The Model Maker. And it was actually a British magazine for people who built scale models. And that magazine kind of got exported to America. And was actually picked up by Kalmbach for a while, was published by them. Mm-hmm. And then Kalmbach sold it to Model Craftsman in 1940, and it got absorbed into Model Craftsman. So one of the oldest model making magazines out there dates back to 1924, called The Model Maker. And that's part of our heritage.
Well, do you remember
at RMC?
Do you remember Bruce and the Bruces and other, well, Kelly and Bruce?
Right, Kelly and Bruce.
Yeah, sorry. And it took me a while to teach that. We were talking to Chris Brimley there a month or two ago, and we found Shorpy, which is a
great resource for vintage photos. Yeah,
yeah.
Well, some has found Shorpy; others knew it existed.
Well, okay, I discovered Shorpy that night, and there was a picture, and I found it again. I'm looking at it right now. And it was December 11th, 1925, Washington, D.C., Margaret Schwartzel. The Schwartzel is not just a model train, it's a system. Who can tell us more? So the hobby was, I think maybe one of the points to make about this, and then we'll get off away from the 30s and 40s because I have questions, but I think one of the points to make is before the magazines and before the NMRA were born, the hobby was starting to develop into something that needed the magazines and needed the organization.
So you were right at a cusp in the 30s. Electric trains were still being sold. You know, Lino and an American Flyer were, and Ives. You still had, several early tin plate manufacturers. They were advancing. They were advancing. I wouldn't call it a hobby. And I think there was only a select number of people who were taking these tin plate trains and doing more than just running them on a loop of track on the living room rug. And I think once people saw the potential where it's like, hey, maybe I can set up some tables and like run a loop around the basement, around the attic or whatever. And then people are like, hey, what if I, bang together another, I have some cardboard here and some paint. What if I bang together a car and buy a set of trucks for it? But the thing was, to answer Bruce's original question, was that the hobby was centered on model building. People's accomplishments were building the scale model. You took the plans, or maybe you made measurements of your own, whatever it was. You drew up plans, you copied plans, and you made that scale model. And maybe you would spend months making a scale model of a caboose or a Pullman car or a trolley or whatever caught your interest. You would spend months in your workshop or on your card table making as exact model as you could, out of cardboard, out of strip wood, maybe out of stamped metal. There were very few parts available, even things we take for granted, like getting a set of trucks and couplers. Very few of those on the market, if there was a market. There was maybe two or three suppliers, a handful of suppliers. Another important business launched in 1932, speaking of suppliers, and that'd be our friends at Walther's. William K. Walther's launched his business in 1932. The wholesaling part didn't come around till much later, but...
That's fascinating. It's fascinating that this all kind of started at the same time.
Walther's in 32, Craftsman in 33, MR in 34, NMRA in 35. And I think once the magazines started coming around, we have articles in our first year talking about methods of model railroad control, block wiring, relays, making signal systems. So I think people were definitely trying to do more with their trains than run them in circles. So I think you had two camps. You had people who had electric trains, and they were already building railroads using those electric trains. And then you had people who were just building scale models for the fun and the challenge of building a scale model. Then you had the machinists who were sitting there turning their own drivers, turning their own worm gears and cams to make, whatever it is for their steam locomotive. I mean, you read these articles about guys who spent 2 and 3 years literally scratch building a locomotive out of brass. They didn't have a railroad to run it on. It was literally the challenge of making the scale model. So I think what brings us out of the 30s and 40s, and of course you have early HO scale being developed and pushed in the 30s. Pioneers like Varney, Varney and his early electric motor, and then later the Pittman motors, when you finally had those smaller DC motors, now you could have smaller trains, and HO started getting a foothold in the 30s, but it was nowhere near developed, even by the 1950s, And then the war steps in, the war disrupts everything. So really after the war, I think is when you start seeing the hobby start to mature beyond just building models, beyond just doing tin plate. Now people are thinking about building model railroads. And here we are, we're poised with publications like Railroad Model Craftsman taking advantage of that post-war market.
And in the, this is a question I wanted to ask, but not exactly sure how to word it, but I'll give it a shot. Like I've said before, I was aware of Railroad Model Craftsman in the late 60s and occasionally bought it. But when the V&O story came out, that's when I was hooked, and I never left the hobby shop without the two main magazines under my arm each month. And to me, RMC was just as valuable to me as MR was. But so, like, for me, it was the mid-70s when all of a sudden RMC became important to me. In the 50s or the 60s or the 50s and 60s, was there any kind of articles, momentous event that, like, where were the two magazines as they went through the 50s and 60s? Were they kind of like always there every month? But it was like, what was the differences in the magazines? Maybe that, I don't know. What is the question I'm trying to ask here, Bruce?
Compare and contrast RMC and MR.
It's
in the 50s.
I think MR, you know, you definitely had Lynn Westcott pushing the envelope. You saw a lot more electronics come into play. I know Lynn Westcott pushed an early signal system based on relays and whatnot, and he was always interested in getting more electronics into the magazine. Lynn Westcott helped advance the idea of L-girder benchwork that we kind of take for granted today. Even in the 40s, you had Frank Ellison and his Delta lines. You know, how many people today talk about Frank Ellison and the Delta lines? Mm. Here was a guy who pioneered O-scale 2-rail by taking the center line L-rail out of the center and moving it off to the side. So, okay, you have a third rail, but at least it's off to the side, and it makes your trains look more realistic. But Frank Ellison was one of the first people who talked about your model railroad is more than just trains running in a circle. Your model railroad should pick up a car from here and deliver it there. You should have a yard. You should have a station. You should have whatever. What, you know, Frank Ellison was kind of like dropping the germ of those ideas. And as I was doing research about Allen McClelland and the Virginian in Ohio and all the pioneering things that Allen did, Allen was directly influenced by Frank Ellison. So here we go through the generations. I don't want to say that we're just mimicking from one to the next, but here's Frank Ellison in the 40s dropping ideas on everyone. Hey, we should run our railroads more realistically. Hey, we should have more realistic scenery. Hey, we should do this. Hey, we should do that. Allen's reading this. By the time he's designing the VNO in the 50s and 60s, he's like, that is exactly what I do, but I'm going to take it a step further. I'm going to take it five steps further, because Allen didn't know that you couldn't design a linear railroad walk around control, because walk around controls didn't exist yet. Allen just kind of brute forced it and made it happen. But again, I think that was the shift you saw in MR. You saw some technological stuff come forward. I think RMC was still finding its voice. There was always the focus on the craftsman aspect, people building models. We were always publishing scale plans. You always had all of that. Hal Carstens became the editor in the mid-50s. And I think he was definitely, as you definitely saw an explosion of new in the post-war market, as manufacturing changed, the introduction of plastic, getting us away from cast metal and wood and strip wood. Hal Carstens was pushing new products. But I don't think the magazine truly found its voice. And I said it before, until Tony Koester came on board in 69 and really started pushing the envelope for more what we consider to be a modern concept of scale model railroading in the hobby.
Yeah. And it's like, the magazine was always known for great plans, and like, you never really wanted to be without Railroad Model Craftsman, because it always had great plans and great stuff in it.
And even in the 50s, Hal Carstens had a great collection of black and white negatives that he shot around the New York area. So even every once in a while, he'd be like, here's a gallery of Erie Railroad steam locomotives, or here's a gallery of New York Central diesels I shot. And just, you know, just getting some of that prototype perspective out there. Again, it's kind of hard to put your finger on it, because I think even as a hobby, model railroading was searching for its voice in the post-war era. And again, I've glossed over a whole bunch of RMC history to get us here, but you see the magazines drive the hobby, and the hobby drives the magazines, because I think the purpose of publications is to obviously disseminate information so that people can build better models. But also, it's the readers who drive the publications, because they're the ones sending in the material that gets in the magazines. And in a way, you know, I'm sitting here in the editor's chair, and even today, I'm surprised at the kind of submissions I get and where they lean towards versus what I thought we'd be publishing, you know. And I can't really say that I'm surprised. Model railroading is such a huge and colorful and diverse hobby.
Did Hal Carstens buy it, or did Hal, was Hal Carstens the editor first?
So, backtracking a little bit, Emmanuel Steary founded the Model Craftsman Publishing Company in New York City. And in the first year, 1933, Charles Penn becomes the advertising manager. And by 1935, he's purchased the company from Emmanuel Steary, and now Charles Penn is the publisher and editor of Model Craftsman. And then there's been a rotating cast of editors throughout.
Yeah.
But the tradition always seems to be that, even though I couldn't tell you how much Charlie Penn was literally managing the day-to-day operations of the magazine, but it seemed like that there was always a managing editor under him. But Charlie Penn wanted to keep the title of editor, probably because he wanted to have the final say of what was in the magazine. And Charlie Penn was also an industry guy. He grew up with a lot of the pioneering O-scale manufacturers. He had a hobby shop himself that he later sold. But he was involved in that industry side. I'm not sure if he was a modeler himself, but he was definitely interested in the industry and the manufacturers. So Charlie Penn bought the company in 35. And then in 1952, Hal Carstens joins the staff as an associate editor. He works his way up. By 1955, Hal becomes managing editor. Then he becomes editor. And then in 62, that's when Charlie Penn retires. And Hal bought out the company. And I think it was a few years later that it was renamed Carstens Publications.
So
then Hal became technically the third publisher of Railroad Model Craftsman.
So this Charlie Penn fella,
yes,
he actually owned it for like 30 years.
Yes.
Wow.
That's... Yeah, it seems like almost we went through a cycle. Every 30 years, we have to change out publishers or so.
Right. And so really, there's only been Charlie Penn. The other guy owned it. The guy that started it, he owned it for like a couple of years.
And he was out.
Yeah, and sold it to Charlie Penn, which actually I find kind of fascinating that back in the 30s, I mean, it was probably a nominal sum, but back in the 30s, it was still worth selling. It was still worth for somebody to buy it. Like, I'm convinced beyond a shadow of a doubt since I started this podcast, this hobby has always been way bigger than anybody realizes. It's just because, like, you hear these things, like what we're talking about tonight, you know, this guy starts it, he sells it to another guy, Charlie Penn. Charlie Penn keeps it for 30 years, and it's a lot of work to make a magazine, so it must have been well worth his while. Plus, he was a lover of the hobby. Then how?
You know, as an aside, I think it's interesting that there's certain names generationally that just fall off our tongue. You know, we all know certain writers and certain authors that we grew up with, right? And I feel like...
Let me stop you right there. If we're going to go through every article I've ever written in the Model Railroad Press, let's stop now because...
But I mean, I feel like it's been a couple of generations. Like, no one's been talking about Frank Ellison and Charlie Penn and Lynn Westcott. And they all had valuable contributions to the hobby.
Huge.
But I feel... And I hate to say, like, you know...
Lynn McClelland.
Yeah.
Absolutely. What happened?
Yeah, no, I was going to interrupt. We talked about Frank Ellison on one of our
versions. We did.
The first one, wasn't it?
Yeah, we got to do more of that.
Not that long ago.
Yeah, we got to do.
I feel like our hobby is one where it's like, if you really trace back where we get some of our basic concepts from that we take for granted today, it's like, oh, well, who invented car card and waybill? Oh, this guy. Well, it turns out this guy was influenced by an article he read in 1950. You go find that one. You go, oh, well, some guy actually talked about it in 1930.
Yeah. Well, it's like I said, I found that photo on Shorpy from 1925 of some guy's daughter operating his model railroad as a system. 1925. Right. You know, like, it's, and now we're going to come, we got more to say, but I think the prelude is really leads into the question that I've asked you like about a half a dozen times every time I talk to you. Like, we're talking about names in the hobby and people who've been editors and people who've steered the hobby in a certain direction. Like, have you ever kind of woken up kind of going, holy crap, I'm kind of like one of those guys now. You know, like, it's important.
I had a really sobering moment. I compiled a little, you'll see it in the March issue, one of the history features. I just broke out a little box and I listed all the editors. Turns out we had like 15 editors, and I'm, you know, but when I added my own name to the list, it was weird. It was weird. I mean, weird in a good way, but I'm like,
sure.
Whoa, my, like, look, I'm no Lynn Westcott. Okay. I'm no Tony Koester. You know, I am not putting myself in that pantheon, but it was a little, I got a little tingle. I'm like, wow, that's kind of neat. I'm on this list now.
I understand that you don't want to compare yourself to names that have become well known in the hobby. However, I would stick to my thought of this position you hold right now, and the fella that has your position at Model Railroader. This is a really important time. Like, there have been guys who've been the editor of Railroad Model Craftsman in the 50s and 60s that could kind of just go from month to month. And, you know, they didn't have to worry about trying to keep the magazine alive in the digital age. And now I would say that, you know, your position and your point, your time in the magazine's history is really important, because you got to, you know, you're fighting with digital media, and you got to try to make it interesting, which, by the way, I can't go past anytime. Sometimes when we're in the Southern studio, we go to this one particular mall when I want to go to the Apple store, and we always walk through Borders, and I always go over to the man, and I'm like, I don't want to go to the Apple store today, because I cannot walk past the magazine section in Borders without buying RMC. Because it feels like a magazine from the 80s. It feels and looks like a magazine from the, it really is. It takes me back.
Well, boys, I'm gonna tell you a secret, and I hope my friends at MR are closing their ears right now. But one of the things I wanted to do was I wanted to give readers the same experience reading magazines that I had when I was a kid growing up in the 80s.
Mm. Mm-hmm. I think you've done it.
And I think we've talked about this before. Like, magazines have a rhythm. They have mileposts, and they have, like, you can pull open your favorite magazine, whether it's Railroad Model Craftsman, whether it's Road and Track, whether it's Architectural Digest, whatever your favorite magazine is, they have it laid out in a way. You know, if you flip about 20 pages in, you're going to be in the product reviews. If you flip another 10 pages forward, you're going to be in the features. You flip to the back of the book, you're going to find all the columns. You don't realize it, but we've set it up that way on purpose so that you have an enjoyable experience. However you choose to read the magazine, you know, I get people write me like, I turn to the back and I read your column first, or I dive right into the product reviews first, or I want to read Perspective every month, you know, but they don't have to go hunting for it. We put it in the same spot every month.
Yeah.
That coupled with the, you know, I remember reading all the magazines. They all had the same recipe. Visit a layout, have a construction feature, do a painting and weathering feature. You know, it's every month you're in some sort of combination of modeling, visiting, planning, building. Have a scale. You know, I try to include scale drawings every month. I try to include a layout visit every month. I want to do painting and weathering every month. I want to have a construction feature, you know, whatever it is. I want you to have that same experience where you're going to see a lot of different aspects of the hobby from a lot of different perspectives. We had a feature a couple months ago about kitbashing a boat. And you're like, what do boats have to do with Railroad Model Craftsman? Well, I'll tell you. Number one, if you go to our very first issue, March 33, the illustration on the cover is a guy building a boat. But that's not why I put it on there. But think about it. Railroads have a big history with having their own marine divisions, like car floats and car ferries and tugboats. So here we are. We have the kitbashing feature, how to do a New York Central tugboat, you know, things like that. Before we get too far
afield. I grew up in Windsor.
And sure.
That was a big thing between Windsor and Detroit. Those car ferries shuttling back and forth across the river. It was fascinating to watch them.
And it's and again, just all these different diverse aspects of the hobby. I actually have the list of all the Craftsman editors here. Would you like to hear it?
Absolutely. Sure. Yeah, would you like a little background music for it?
Yes.
At least a drum roll.
So starting in 1933, you had Emanuel Steary. 1935, Edward Hamilton took over. 1937, Weston Farmer was there for about a year. 1938, Harold Luce. 1940, Frank Wilson. 1942, Emmy Fornshell. 1942 to 1946 was H. Winfield Secor. 1946 to 1947 was Robert Thompson. And then 1948, his brother took over, James H. Thompson. 1954, Hal Carstens comes in. Hal Carstens kind of overlaps with Tony Koester because Hal claims that he was editor through 1979, but... but that's fine. I think, again, he, you know, Hal just always wanted to kind of have the last word.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah, exactly. But
so he's got Tony Koester listed from 71 to 81. And I think part of that is Tony originally came on as an associate editor and then later was promoted to managing editor. So
sure. Yeah,
he has Tony listed from 71 to 81. And then we have our longest serving editor, Bill Schaumburg, from 1981 to 2013.
Wow.
Then you have Chris D'Amato from 2013 to 2014. And then in 2015, you had Stephen Priest.
And then who after
2019?
Who came after Stephen Priest?
Some guy.
So really, but from 1954 to present, in that, don't tell me, 77 years, you've had like four or five guys. Only four or five people have been editor of, if you take out Chris D'Amato, who was the editor for a very, very short period of time.
And Chris was on staff with Bill for like all those 30 years too. Yeah, so it's like, yeah. Really, you know, Chris was there.
Yeah.
And so what happened was Bill Schaumburg retired in 2013 and then Chris D'Amato was promoted. And then unfortunately the company closed. and then when we reactivated, Stephen Priest took the spot.
Right. Yeah. Poor old Chris. He kind of showed up at the wrong time. But you're right. He was there all those years with Bill Schaumburg. I mean, his name is well recognizable in the history of Railroad Model Craftsman because he was there.
Absolutely.
For all those years.
I think he also penned a fair number of articles as well, did he not?
Oh, yeah. No, he used to write a fair amount. And he also, there's been a long-standing tradition of a little bit of staff sharing between Craftsman and Railfan. And I think I told you when I took over in 2019, I got a fair amount. I'm not even joking. It was hate mail. I got a fair amount of hate mail from, I'm just going to say it, from some grumpy old men who were like, who do you think you are? You're just some jerk from Railfan. You don't even like model railroading. You know, how dare you? And I'm like, okay, I've only been doing this my entire life. Who are you? but I didn't like it, you know? And it's like, if you look back in our history, Tony Custer's on the masthead of RMC. Guess who else is on the masthead of RMC? Jim Boyd, who came to Carstens to be the editor of Flying Models. No one knows that. He was working on flying models.
I think when we interviewed Tony, I think he talked about that. Yeah.
Until Hal was ready to launch Railfan in 1974, then he moved over to that. But when we launched Railfan, guess who was on the master to Railfan? Tony Koester was right there as one of his editors.
Well, yeah, but I think you got to ignore. I mean, there's been crusty people, and there's crusty people everywhere in everything. I mean, I thought it was
ridiculous. It didn't keep me up at night. No. I just thought it was like, what a waste of a stamp. You know, I'm like of all the things you could have done, you got up this morning and you did this. Like, I felt sorry for them. And I also felt sorry that they couldn't figure out how closely tied the two hobbies are together. You can't be a model railroader without liking real. You can like real trains and not be a model railroader. You cannot be a model railroader and not be a rail fan.
Well, back in the middle of January, we released our first interview with a fellow named Danny Harmon, who does YouTube videos, Distant Signal, which are very, very popular. He has a very large following. And he was talking about he has no interest in model railroading whatsoever. And I said to him, I said, and I can understand that, but there isn't a model railroader alive today that isn't a rail fan. All model railroaders are rail fans.
Mm-hmm. If I can quote from Allen McClelland in the V&O story, the very first line says, if the Virginian and Ohio has a philosophical basis, I suspect it's steeped in my personal conviction that rail fanning and model railroading go hand in hand. In order to create a realistic miniature railroad, one must understand the prototype.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely true. Yes.
Well, yeah. I've always said that I was a model railroader first and was never particularly interested in knowing locomotives or knowing cars or knowing anything else. I was a model railroader first because that's the way I was raised. But when I drive back and forth from Florida, from the southern office to the northern office, if I'm by myself, I'm always pulling into Thurman, West Virginia to see what's going on down there. I mean, what model railroader amongst us isn't always out, you know, tracking down one-to-one trains. I mean, I saw one tonight, the auto train, the great big auto train.
It's funny because, again, if you look at Railfan in the 70s, there's Bill Schaumburg drawing maps. There's Tony Koester taking pictures. There's Jim Boyd writing stories. You look at RMC. There's Jim Boyd. Not only was Jim Boyd contributing prototype Railfan articles like, hey, here's a story about Illinois Central Elko Centuries or something like that. Half the photos in the V&O story are shot by Jim Boyd. Mm. And he's taking amazing, because he's also looking through his lens as a rail fan. He is literally rail fanning the V&O, and his views are amazing.
Yeah, and you know, so the fact that he pulled that off shows what a superb job Al McClellan did at building that railroad.
Absolutely, absolutely. And the reason I've actually been doing so much research about the V&O, I've actually been working on this for a few months. Folks are going to see on the March issue, we put the V&O on the cover.
Oh, cool. That's cool.
For a huge retrospective. Yeah.
That is cool. Good. That is very cool.
The sad part is I've been working on this for the last few months, and it was originally supposed to be a nice, you know, victory lap for Allen.
Yeah.
And unfortunately it turned into a tribute instead, but I don't want people to think that we did it just because of his passing. This has been in the works for a while, because as we were approaching our 90th last year, I'm thinking, well, who do I want to put on the cover? I don't want to just put, look, any layout would be deserving to be on the cover. Don't get me wrong, but the 90th anniversary is special. And honestly, the work that Allen did to propel his own model railroad forward also propelled the hobby forward. And as we're marking 90 years of hobby history, what better landmark than the V&O?
Right.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yep. Good. Yep.
Here, I've got a question for you. We're talking about philosophy of magazines and that type of thing. Do you think it makes a difference as to the ownership team and management team of the publishing companies are active model railroaders or not in what the product they're putting out is?
if you don't have an interest in the hobby, it's going to show. You know, going all the way back to Charlie Penn may not have been building models, but he definitely understood the hobby from the business side. He cultivated relationships with hobby shops, manufacturers. And he probably did a lot of that because he realized that's where his bread and butter was coming from for advertising support. But I think he also had an interest in railroading in general. As most people did in the 30s, railroads were a large part of our culture, more so than they are today. So it you could definitely throw this magazine at someone who had a passing interest in trains, and they'd be like, oh, yeah, no, I could get into this. Sure, you know. But no, like, you know, Charlie Penn had a huge interest in the industry side. Hal Carstens grew up a rail fan, grew up as a tin plater, coming to the magazine. One of the things that he really enjoyed, Hal enjoyed the industry side as well, cultivating those relationships. Like, he was personal friends with Irv Ather, and he was personal friends with Gordon Varney. He was personal friends with, you know, all these guys.
Leo Campbell.
Right. He was friends with all of them. If you get a chance, Hal published a book, and I think we still have a few copies left in our bookstore, 150 Years of Train Models. And it's kind of Hal Carstens' rambling history and recollections of our early hobby history. But you'll see he really enjoyed, I think part of it was like he enjoyed knowing like the people who own these companies, but I think he genuinely enjoyed cultivating friendships with those people. You know, it went beyond just business.
It's sold out. As soon as you said it, I went to look at books on the White River Productions page.
Because
it's sold out.
Then you'll have to look, find it on the secondary market, because I know they're out there. And okay. Again, it was kind of a misunderstood book when it came out, because it was kind of Hal Carstens' pet project.
Yeah.
But it describes all those early relationships, and it describes how these people started their businesses, and how they grew into becoming important parts of the hobby industry.
Well, that's the thing that you cannot ignore. Rapido trains. That is the thing you cannot ignore is like, there's a ton of this hobby. I'm so annoyed that I'm not 10 years younger and I'm not going to get to enjoy this for another 10, you know, after I wish I was 10 or 20 years younger. And of course, then I wish I knew what I knew now back 40 years ago. But I mean, this hobby is steeping with history. It's steeping with the people that you meet and you know. And I mean, it's just that's what has made this hobby so cool. Is like our friend John Doering says, who's on the board of directors for the NMRA these days. I mean, you think you're getting into model railroading, but what you're really getting into is a culture, a way of life.
Oh, absolutely. You know, and you know, before we forget, you know, Kevin Udaly, owner of White River Productions, is no slouch either. You know, he grew up rail fanning with his dad and his brother. And Kevin told me, like, he had this whole Missouri Pacific layout planned. He was custom painting and detailing all these engines and doing all this stuff. And he was planning the big layout he was going to build. So, like, you know, Kevin definitely has both feet in both sides of the industry, on the rail fanning side.
Oh, yeah.
And the model railroading side. And you talk to Kevin, he's just like, yeah. And then I decided to start a publishing company and raise a family. And then that kind of took the time away from building a layout. So,
well, it's because of Kevin's dad, Jimmy Daly, that a lot of people in Kansas don't like me.
No, there's another story.
Yeah. Well, it's a true story. You were there, Bruce.
I was there. It is a true story.
We're going from one layout to another, we went for an operating weekend in Kansas City, and going from one layout to another, somebody had whispered in my ear, you know, you really should go and see Jimmy Daly's layout, who apparently wasn't in that group. He was in a different group, the out group, and he wasn't with the in kid, the cool kids. And the guy goes, you really need to see Jim Udaly's layout. So somehow we got a hold of Jim Udaly, and we stopped there at lunchtime. And I've told this story 20 times on the podcast now, I will never, I mean, we weren't there 10 minutes and Jim goes, you want to see a train run? Sure. Hey, you want to run a train? Yeah. He has this beautiful, I don't know, 40 by 60 O scale layout. And I'll never forget, I'm running with
dual CTC machines, right?
Dual CTC machines. And I'm running these two Jeep, C&O Jeep 7s over the crest. And as I'm coming down in these with these O scale, I could hear the slack coming out of the train. And I'm thinking, and I'm turning to the guy, I'm turning to the guys and telling them, tell them we died in a horrible car crash and we couldn't get to the rest of the layouts.
Oh, it was a blast.
I think that's just it too. It's like, you know, and if you talk to Kevin about these magazines, you know, and all of the titles that are in the White River family, you know, Kevin gets excited. He's like, yeah, we have Railroad Model Craftsman and we have Railfan and we have Passenger Train Journal and we have Model Railroad News and we have, you know, and he, you know, he's excited because the publications are that important to him because he grew up with them. He wants to see them thrive. He definitely has an interest in the hobby and the industry. So when people are like, oh, it's just a business, it's like, it can't be just a business, because if it's just a business, you're not going to give it the attention it needs. And that is certainly not the case here.
No, absolutely not. I mean, his dad had the old scale. I mean, imagine your dad having that layout. Okay, before we get too far, I want to talk a little bit about the 70s and the V&O story, because I think that's a huge part of Railroad Model Craftsman history that we can't, you know, skim over, because, as you say, the 90th anniversary is going to feature the V&O on the cover. And, I mean, there's been a lot of, you know, Bill Schaumburg and all the names you mentioned, there's been a lot of great articles and editors after that. But it seemed like it was a huge turning point in the magazine's history. Is that seem?
It's absolutely what put us on the map, as far as I'm concerned. And that's because Tony Koester was cultivating that relationship with Allen. Tony was just like one of us. Like, he just met Allen at a convention. He's like, "Gosh, Mr. McClelland, you sure have a neat layout here." And he's just like, "Call me Allen," you know, and just you know, and. So what's funny, you know, I grew up really knowing more about the Allegheny Midland, which is Tony's railroad, former railroad, because that's what I saw in Model Railroad, and I read about it every month in Trains of Thought and so on. And so I knew Tony and I knew the Allegheny Midland, and I was tangentially aware of the V&O, but I kind of felt like I learned about the V&O coming in through the back door of the Allegheny Midland, you know. And it wasn't until I did more research, Tony's Allegheny Midland, as we know it, is a direct result of his friendship with Allen. Not that he was trying to ape what Allen was doing, but Tony's looking for direction for his own railroad. He's like, well, first he thought he was going to model the nickel plate, and he kind of had this freelance nickel plate idea he was going to build. And then, you know, he visits Allen's railroad and he sees the walkaround design. He's like, no, I need to do walk around with peninsulas. That's the way to do it, you know. And it kind of drove what he's like, well, I could do nickel plate, but gosh, wouldn't it be more fun to do, you know, kind of freelance mountain railroading and maybe connect with my friend Allen's railroad? And they just all had this great idea. Hey, let's connect up with Steve King's, you know, Virginia Midland, and let's have a big party. You know, it's a whole, Allen was all about like, yeah, let's get more people connected to this, because Allen was doing something that no one else was doing, or at least no one else was publishing it. The next big layout I think that we featured after the V&O is Eric Bruman's Utah belt in 78, and Eric Bruman is right behind Allen with the whole proto freelancing thing with his Utah belt. But that said, the V&O story and that whole series was definitely a turning point. And you read for months afterward, just letters and letters and letters, people telling them how influential the V&O story was to them and how they were tearing down their layout to start over, or incorporating Allen's ideas into their existing layout, whatever it was. Definitely a landmark turning point. Like I said, up until that point, Tony was definitely working on focusing on the art of scale modeling. That was a big change. partnering with Allen and getting the V&O story in, huge turning point. And I think that opened the floodgates for more, not copycat content, but people delivering the same kind of like-minded, again, not copying Allen, but yes, I also have an approach to proto freelancing. Would you like to hear about it? You know, well, and I don't think you saw that anywhere else at the time.
I think in Allen's case, he was, you know, like, right or not, he's kind of the guy who was in the right place at the right time to put forward all his thoughts on what he was trying to achieve. Was he was trying to achieve modeling a railroad. And I know if you read through his articles, it's, you know, he didn't model the whole railroad. He modeled part of it, that, you know, the railroad extended beyond each end of his basement to connect with other places. So, you know, he developed the whole history, the whole scenarios, how this thing operated and interacted with other railroads. And he was there at the right time, the right place, with the right story to tell it. And people started looking, oh, so I just don't need to have a big room filled thing with some access holes here and there and cabs up on a elevated platform to run a layout. I can actually
walk
around with my train.
So Tony and I were talking about this a while ago. When Allen was planning the V&O in 1957, this is when you started to see an influx of plastic models come into the market. And you read the editorials at the time, and everyone's like, plastic will be the downfall of this hobby. You know, it's, you know, this cheap garbage can't replace craftsmanship. And it's like, and not all models were created equal, for sure. But the fact that you had more mass-produced, inexpensive models coming on the market, in Allen's case, he wants to model long coal trains. Well, you can buy a fleet of Athern Twin Bay Hoppers and have an inexpensive fleet of, you can have like a long 10-car train and it won't break the bank. You also don't need to spend months building it. You just need a screwdriver, you know? Yeah. So
he also fostered, if I can't see from 3 feet, why bother? You know, that the 3 foot good enough rule. And it's true. You know, you can look at his layout when it was operating. It was a train. You didn't notice that, you know, from 3 feet away, you know, who made the car or anything. You know, it could have been some super detailed thing that costs $150, and you put it against, you know, the Athern 325 one, you can tell them apart at the distance. So that was another big concept, I think, had the good enough concept. Like, don't worry about, you know, if the boxcars don't have, you know, standalone grab irons and ladders and stuff, you can make them look perfect, and nobody's going to know.
But I think in the 1950s, what model railroading was, if you had the space, you were building a railroad, and it was either a tabletop, like a 4x8 or a 5x9, or maybe you built something that filled your basement, but in either case, you were controlling it from a central control panel.
Yes, exactly.
And the theory was, and that was because of the practicalities of what was available. There was no concept of walk-around control. You had a central transformer, a central control panel. Now, the real trick was you'd have your control panel with all your switches wired to it so you could throw all your turnouts. And the real thing was you'd invite your friends to come down and be like, hey, boys, watch this. You'd get train number one running with all your block control, and you're like a maestro throwing all your switches, you know. And you're like, okay, here comes train number two. Ooh, ah, now you're control. You know, the whole trick was you're one person throwing all these switches, and the trains are just going on these overlapping dog bone loops, and you know, it's like, okay, boys, now train. It's like juggling, right? And now the third chainsaw, you know, and that was at the time, that was the skill and the challenge of model railroading. You built a layout, and to operate the layout meant that the trains ran through scenery. And maybe you want to challenge yourself and run two trains at once, you know, and that doesn't make it bad or wrong. That is literally just what the state of the art was in the 1950s.
Yeah. And one exception to that rule, I think, well, and you'll probably agree, this guy named Frank Ellison had it figured out.
Frank Ellison, and even like John Armstrong with his Canandaigua Southern.
John Armstrong, I've been reading up on some of his stuff of late, and you know, he's talking about, he's developing these track plans, the 50 with, you know, eventually, you know, it's going to be some walk around and says, oh, I just drew it, figured out. By the time somebody built the thing, they'd have figured out how to control it.
Exactly. And I think, so that's where the hobby broke out, because remember we talked about in the 20s and 30s, the hobby was, look, I'm either running my electric tin plate trains and I just bought more track and switches and accessories and I made a bigger system, or I'm some sort of craftsman who is, you know, spending years and months building one model at a time and not thinking about how to build these wonderful scale models and run them on a system that's a railroad. Once you start getting more inexpensive models on the market, rolling stock and structures, now you were freed up to be like, huh, maybe I can actually build a model railroad and finish it in my lifetime. And that didn't mean that you weren't going to build other aspects. You could still scratch build a bridge. You could still scratch build rolling stock, but you were freed up from having to scratch build everything. You could actually get that system up and running in your lifetime and enjoy it. And I think that's what Allen and others were propelling, that you can build these large systems, replicate a real railroad, and do it in your lifetime.
Yeah, good point. And the other point, you know, it, and you'll still see it today, that people will put down the guys who are, you know, buying ready to run stuff and doing that rather than, well, back in my day, we had to get the cereal box and the soup cans and make everything. And you know, this guy here, he's just buying $300 worth of stuff. It's not a real model railroad, but you know, some, like you say, the guy has the ability to get something up and running instead of trying to crank together kit after kit after kit that take a long time to do. Is he having fun doing it? Absolutely. May in the future he come back and replace some of the stuff from where he did stuff? Probably. You never know. But model railroading is fun. That's the key thing.
So I think RMC was definitely important in pushing that to the forefront. But I think we were also careful that, like, hey, this is not the only way to railroad. We featured plenty of other model railroads that did not follow Allen's concepts, and they were great in their own way. So I think it was highly influential, but I hope that people didn't feel intimidated, like that was the only way to do it.
No, I agree with that 100%. That's kind of one of my bugaboos, is every way. If you want to build a three rail layout and you just want to run trains around in a circle and admire your trains, model railroading, just as much as if you develop this huge operating system for. I believe I go to my grave going, both are in model railroading. Both are just as valuable if you enjoy it.
That's the key. Are you having fun? If you're having fun, you're doing it right.
I got absolutely. All right. All right. 100%. All right. As the new editor guy, should we recreate pillar number, what was it? Pillar 64 or 68?
Pillar 68.
Yes. Pillar 68. What a great. Kelly, you've been awfully quiet.
Oh, I'm just thinking.
Well, I know, but you're supposed to come
he's
on.
He's in rapt attention of
when he was talking about that list, and he said he didn't feel his name was up to the same as what's going on with the past. It's you've been passed the torch.
Yeah,
and you're gonna make you've already made your name. I mean,
I'll say personally, since you took over, RMC has blossom and become a much better publication. You know, you seem to hit the right balance of types of articles and things every month. And I can't recall of late one that I kind of, well, why did I bother getting this one? Like every one you read, you know, there's two or three articles in it that will just blow me away. Go, wow, this is cool. You know, you had one a little while ago about dairies and things like that.
Sure, and, sure. You know, I appreciate that. Thank you for noticing.
There's all, I haven't seen a layout an issue since you took over that I would just kind of like toss aside and not spend a great amount of time looking at it. And I'll look at all the articles. Will I read them all? No, I'll skim through them, but you know, some I'll read and I'll read again. And, you know, there's something you can learn, and the mix you have is great.
And I appreciate that. One of the other things I was talking with Tony about, we're talking about influential events of the 70s, with more people taking an interest in the prototype, you start to see the shift towards prototype modeling. One of the things of the hobby, a manufacturer like Athearn would have to invest a lot of money into new tooling. They're going to tool, I hate to say generic, they're going to tool a 40-foot boxcar that is based on the AAR design, and they're going to decorate it for 20 different railroads so they can sell a bunch of boxcars and get their money back on the tooling. The technology didn't exist, and I think the market didn't exist. If Athearn came out with a boxcar and they're like, well, here's a Santa Fe AAR boxcar, but the Chicago Northwestern one is a little different. First of all, I don't think they could afford to do the tooling because of the way manufacturing was back then. No, they're going to do one boxcar, but then it's up to people like, I'm thinking like modelers like Jeff English, who was like a great freight car modeler. You saw a lot of his work. Ted Colletta, you saw a lot of his work. They'll take that Athearn 40-foot boxcar. They'll do the modifications and show you what they did to make it a New York Central car, to make it a Santa Fe car. And as people started noticing the differences, if you look at early advertisements for like diesel models in the 50s, you could buy a metal, we would call it like an Alco S1. We know it as the Alco S1 today. They were advertising it in the model magazines as like the 1000 horsepower switcher. And if there was an RS3 model, there wasn't phase two and phase three RS3s. First of all, no one even knew that they were coming out in phases. No one noticed that this hood louver was over here and this hatch was moved over here. Oh, Canadian Pacific has RS3s. New York Central has RS3s.
Yeah.
It must be the same RS3.
Yeah, you're making a huge point there. You're making a huge point. That's one of the ways the industry and the hobby has changed in the last 10 to 15 years is, you know, oh, this locomotive had this feature. This locomotive had that feature. I talk often with our friend Jason Schron from Rapido Trains. One of the finest.
Fast tracked him out of railroading fun.
Yeah, let me do that again because you know, Otto, this is about the 90th anniversary of Railroad Model Craftsman. But would you mind? We try to be as transparent here at the old AML as possible. Accuracy for us really isn't of any concern. But would you mind if I conducted some in-house business during your time here?
No, I understand. Please continue.
Kelly, you do understand the point of being a co-host is you ask questions and get involved.
I know.
Well, you hardly ever do. You're quiet. It's your church mouse.
I know, because I'm soaking all this in. I mean,
yeah, because I'm asking all the questions.
I know.
I got another question.
That's good. Hang on.
Can I bring it? I'll bring it up after our in-house meeting is done.
Yeah.
Otto, stay away from those shrimp.
Yeah, Otto. Yeah. Otto, if you're unhappy with this podcast in any way, I apologize. We tried to do our best, but trust me, if you're unhappy and it didn't turn out well, direct all your complaints to Kelly, because everything that goes everything that goes wrong here is Kelly's fault.
That's right. Well, I also wanted to mention, so like coming out of the 70s into the 80s, some of the things we were talking about, you saw the transition, things we take for granted, moving away from dyed sawdust to ground foam for scenery.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Moving like we almost went bankrupt buying lichen. I think we wiped out all the forests in Norway. making dyed glycol lichen, moving away from lichen and going to like fiber balls and ground foam, you know, just little shifts like that. Or even command control, like it was wonky and a lot of people not everyone adopted it, but like command control existed. Mm-hmm. I think command control helped people build bigger, if they wanted the bigger walk around layout. Command control, let them do it.
You know what? I just had a great idea for one of your perspectives one month. It wouldn't really make an article, but I would love to do this. And I think I may do this. I would love to do like one of your perspective columns solely focused on Jim Scores and his development of NCE. Because I am fascinated with the beginning of his company was he was at the National Convention in Philadelphia. A guy did a clinic about DCC, and he left the convention and drove through the night back to Rochester because he was so excited about what the future held and what he was going to do with it. Like, I think it would be great just to kind of somehow build that up into a perspective. It wouldn't make much of an article, but it would be a great.
I think there's, again, we take DCC for granted, and DCC is kind of an outgrowth of the old analog command control systems. But again, things that we take for granted. And then you go into the 80s. Now, not only do you have plastic kits on the market, now you have resin kits. And not only do you have plastic and resin, oh, by the way, a little company named Evergreen is now putting out every dimension and shape of strip styrene and sheet styrene that you can think of, opening up a whole other facet of scratch building and model building. Just all these things. People moving away from spaghetti bowl layouts and building walk-around layouts. More proto freelancers. More people doing prototype modeling. The rise of the railroad prototype modeler meets. All this stuff. And then into the late 80s, early 90s, the manufacturers refining their systems to the point where they can start producing more specific models. They don't need to make the generic F unit, the generic Jeep 30. They can make the phase one F3. They can make the FP7. They can make this with a winterization hatch, this without. And then, today, I never thought I would see a plastic SDL 39, which is essentially like a six-axle Jeep 38. I'm probably doing this wrong, but you know what I mean? Like, only built for Milwaukee Road, and then they're available in mass-produced plastic. You know, when I was a kid, I never thought I would see a mass-produced FL9. The FL9 were the dual-mode diesels that pulled the commuter trains where I grew up, and Rapido made a whole fleet of them in, like, several paint schemes and rebuilt and unrebuilt because there's a market for it, and the manufacturing has finally caught up to that market. So again, all these things that we take for granted, it's been a slow buildup, a steady buildup, not necessarily slow. The technology has to catch up. I was just writing about 3D printing. The technology for what we call stereolithography, 3D printing, the patents have been out there for years, but it was not a commercially viable product for consumers. You know, what we call 3D printing, the industry called rapid prototyping. Big industries had 3D printing machines where they could rapidly prototype something to see if their drawings worked and all that, but it wasn't designed for mass market consumers. And also some patents had to expire. That's why all of a sudden 2009, you see the first 3D printers come on the market, because I'm glossing over a lot of history, but essentially the patents for the big printers expired. Now you can make affordable 3D printers. And every year since then, they keep getting more and more affordable and more available to average modelers. And now the 3D printer is just another modeling tool that almost any modeler can afford.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, true.
So
we were talking before, you're talking about plastic models and changing and things like that. I'm gapping on the name of the series, but RMC used to run a series. They probably 6 or 7 pages on modifying plastic cars to meet prototypes. I forget what they call it. And you know the ones I'm talking about with it, where they would, here's this car and the prototype, and here's how I'm going to change XYZ manufacturer using all these parts to match that.
Huh?
Yes.
Yeah.
You're trying to remember the name of the column as well. I remember being in there. I forget what it was called.
A specific column in RMC?
Well, a series of articles in RMC. There used to be like
there was
three or four pages.
There was Ted Kawada's Essential Freight Cars that ran for a bunch of years.
Yeah, that could be it.
And that was in the last 15 years or so that we ran that. And Ted Kawada has also published several books, his Speedwitch Media, about essential freight cars and some of the things that he was modeling. We used to run back in the 70s and 80s. We ran a column called Protofile, which was just like
that's what I'm thinking about.
hey, do you want to add telephone boxes to your railroad? Where here's like three or four examples of different telephone boxes along the right of way. And here's some scale drawings. Here's how to add a telephone box to your railroad. Or here's another protofile, Lehigh Valley cabooses. Here's all the differences between different phases of Lehigh Valley Northeastern cabooses thing. So yeah, protofile. I've been trying to look for a way to bring that back and see if there's, because sometimes I get articles in that don't fit any one area. They wouldn't make a good column. They're too short for a feature. And I like protofile is something I've wanted to bring back. And they used to style the page, the outside of the page would look like a file folder tab.
Yeah.
And the inside of the page had three holes, like you would punch it out for a three-ring binder, because they envisioned they wanted you to cut it out from the magazine and put it into a binder and just make your own inspiration book, your own idea book that you could refer to.
Okay. We're running out of network time. And I don't think we should pass by. You say you're having conversations now with Tony, editor to editor, I'm assuming.
Well, I don't want to brag. I want to brag a little bit, but
yeah, well,
because I am a drooling fanboy, and I will admit it. But I think being a drooling fanboy is what helps make the product so great. If you don't have enthusiasm, you have to channel that enthusiasm, but. You have to have that enthusiasm and channel it in the right direction to make this work.
So
I got a question.
Really?
Otto, now he has a question.
Well, I just.
Yeah,
I just,
now he's got a question.
Oh, God.
Holy mackerel.
What year did the magazine go from that real thin paper to the nice glossy paper that you guys do now?
So.
Is that around when.
It was immediately when White River took over.
White River took over?
And. You know, in the last 10 years of Carstens publications, you know, they tried some cost-cutting measures and some were, well, no, none of them worked. And one of them was using a cheaper grade of paper that just didn't reproduce well.
You could see the other page.
Yeah, no, it was bad. And also reducing the trim size. And, you know, it wasn't great. And the first thing that Kevin did was like, we're going back to normal size paper. And honestly, like the difference is it's literally pennies. It's pennies per...
Yeah.
Pennies per issue. It's like when you're buying that much paper in bulk, getting one grade versus the other, it's literally pennies. It's not, you're not talking like millions of dollars. I don't think I'm giving away any trade secrets here, but no. So the change came in 2014, at the end of 2014.
Okay.
Well, we've tried cost cutting measures here actually at the old AML network, but every time I come into the studio, Kelly's still here.
Well, yeah,
that's because you're paying me in the negative.
I thought the
company store.
Yeah,
I thought the bulk rate shrimp was part of your cost cutting system.
Yeah, when the blue and gold shrimp go bad, then I get them and mix them together and they turn green.
You know, oddly enough, the blue and gold is the colors of Rapido trains.
That's right.
You are fast track to model railroading fun.
You know, I feel like we haven't said enough about Rapido trains yet tonight. Let's get a word from our sponsor, Bruce.
Yeah. We haven't said enough about Rapido trains.
This is a good spot for you to throw to, the Queso Cowboy jingle in.
Yeah, I could throw in the jingle. We got a jingle now that we made, but I'm not sure Jason's going to be thrilled with it, but I'm sure I'll hear from him one way or the other.
I personally do need to thank Rapido trains because they have been a huge supporter, not just of Railroad Model Craftsman. And Jason Schron is kind enough to write a, I think, pretty objective column each month about not only his model railroading experience, but his industry experience. But Rapido Trains has been a huge supporter of many of our publications at White River, not just Railroad Model Craftsman. So I am appreciative of that. And it's, quite frankly, a practical matter. Advertising is what propels our publications. That's what keeps the cost down and keeps them affordable for the readers.
Exactly. So
thank you for that.
Well, and I'm just thankful that we only have one sponsor, that Jason wanted to be the sole sponsor of all of the free podcasts, because I've screwed up having Rapido Trains as a sponsor so bad. Can you imagine what it would have been like if I'd had a different sponsor for every show? Oh my God, what a mess that would have been.
Geez.
Man, I can't imagine.
I feel like we should be paying Jason the Rapido Trains. RapidoTrains.com. Go there and buy stuff. Please, I'm begging you.
Jason said go there, see what you want to buy, then see your dealer.
Yeah, actually, yes. Jason is very much about a dealer guy. Yeah. Okay. I don't want to leave without at least 2 or 3 minutes. I'm fascinated by this. You said about how you were having conversations with Tony. I think that's huge because Tony was very, very important in the evolution of Railroad Model Craftsman. You are now the editor of Railroad Model Craftsman. It's obvious to me and anybody else that's listening that you take this position extremely seriously. So if you could give us a little insight without telling any tales out of school, like I'm fascinated. Like, how did this conversation start? Did you kind of contact him and with a couple of questions or something?
I've been annoying and bugging Tony for years, usually like fanboy questions about, you know, the Allegheny Midland, or occasionally I have some research question about the nickel plate. He's been able to point me in the right direction. I have to say, like, again, Tony is very generous with his time. He's a great ambassador for the hobby. He's very patient with me. he's been great. And even before I was doing Railroad Model Craftsman, like, you know, we would correspond off and on. And I always felt bad and have the chance. He tried to line me up with a couple of projects over the years. It just didn't quite pan out through no fault of his. But he's just been, you know, really generous of his time and patient answering my questions. And I actually have a feature in the March 90th anniversary issue where I've reached out to all the past living editors to get their perspective on 90 years of hobby history and some of the changes they saw during their tenure as editor.
What kind of response did you get?
I got a good one. I got, they're all in there. Tony Koester, Bill Schaumburg, Chris D'Amato, and Stephen Priest. They're all there. I put them in. Usually perspective is that little sort of editorial before you get to the main features. I expanded perspective to include their perspectives. And then you're asking, well, Otto, where's yours? Well, I'm in the back of the book in editor's notebook, and you'll be hearing from myself, Harry K. Wong, and also Justin Franz will be giving our perspectives in editor's notebook. So yeah, we have all the editors together in this issue. It's kind of fun getting them all back involved.
Yeah.
And again, it's even funny, like even working with Bill all those years, you know, Bill recruited me to do all this freelance work doing illustrations and track plans and the occasional article over the years. And just, you know, it's like, hey, Bill, now I have your job. And it's kind of weird. You know, it's weird. It's very weird. It's weird. It's weird for 8-year-old Otto. 8-year-old Otto does not understand what is happening right now.
Yeah, it's very cool. It's very much, I was saying to somebody the other day, one of our fans, our loyal fans, was complaining about the podcast where I was arguing with Uncle Dave. And then I realized, I was thinking about it, and I realized that really, this has only ever been my recorded conversations. But then I started to realize, and I only realized this just recently, because of the podcast, I end up having all these great conversations like the one we're having tonight.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And it's just like a total bonus. It's like made the hobby like 10 times better for me because of the conversation. You and I wouldn't have this conversation had it not been that we were putting it on a podcast and putting it out there for the world to hear. It's just, you must be pinching yourself more than once. I mean,
Every day.
Like I know it's hard work because in today's world, you're not all sitting in the same office building and the next office to you isn't Justin or Harry or whatever, but and so I know it's harder to do the job because a lot of times you're doing it individually. But holy mackerel, what a job you guys are doing. You got to be
honest. We work really hard, and we appreciate everyone's support.
Yeah. Good. So, okay. So you and Tony now, do you talk pretty regular?
I honestly really try not to take advantage of his time. Honestly, it's like, you know, like I don't just like call up to him and be like, hey Tony, what are you doing?
Yeah, no, I get it. Yeah, it's not like Tony.
I will say I read. So I also picked up a copy of his I was talking to him more because, you know, Tony just released a book called Allen McClelland and His Virginian in Ohio, which is another reexamination of Allen's contributions to the hobby on the backdrop of the V&O. And that was put out by Kalmbach, came out the end of last year. So when I wrote my V&O story for the March issue, you know, I'm referring to the V&O story we published in the 70s. I'm referring to Tony's book he just put out. I'm referring to Tony's book he published on the Allegheny Midland a few years ago, because they're all cross-referenced, you know. And you should have seen me writing this article. I have like three books on my lap and dozens of RMCs open everywhere. And it's like, you know, I'm going nuts. But also, I'm talking to Tony and I showed him a draft of the articles. I'm like, I want to make sure I'm not cribbing too much. Am I just repeating what's already been said? You know, and I didn't want to repeat what Tony just wrote in his book. Didn't want to repeat what Tony wrote 40 years ago either, you know? So it was really more like, I want to make sure that I'm saying something new and distinct and not just parroting your book. So we had that talk. And he gave me some good pointers there. And we, you know, it's just really, I just want to make sure it read fresh, because I didn't want people to think that I'm jumping on the V&O bandwagon. Been working on this for months. And I said, unfortunately, all these tributes are pouring out, to well-deserved tributes to Allen. I just, it makes me sad that this is now a tribute, unfortunately.
Yeah, exactly.
But, you know, I was reading something in Tony's Allegheny Midland book, and it's an Easter egg. We'll have to come back to it. I don't want to give it away. You're gonna have to pick up the March. You have to pick up the March issue to find it. But it's, Tony talked about the next stage of development. So the Appalachian lines, with the three railroads and the three color schemes. So Appalachian line style, but three color schemes and the individual names of the railroad. That was the first stage of the merger. There was going to be a second stage of the merger. And Tony just mentioned it as a throwaway line in one of his chapters. And I'm like, whoa. So I reached out to Tony and I'm like, tell me more. And it's in the March issue. You'll have to pick it up to see the Easter egg. And we can reconvene and discuss it. And you tell me if this Easter egg was worth withholding. But it was very nice of Tony to go dig that up for me, and I could share it with the readers. So
yeah. This is so cool. This is so cool. I'm glad you contacted me to do this, because, all right, let me ask you this last question. And I never want to, when we're on the podcast, Bruce, Kelly, you can either back me up. Feel free to either contradict me or back me up. But Kelly, are you awake?
I'm awake. I'm listening to you.
Okay.
Jeez.
Well, there's more to being a co-host than just listening.
I know. I'm just.
He's doing great. You're doing great.
Don't encourage him.
I'm oversaturated right now. It's unbelievable.
You probably think about what's on the supper plate.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm going to ask
this question, and then you two guys can tell me if it's okay. Like, do you sit there and kind of go, man, it would kind of be cool to be the editor at the 100th anniversary?
Ooh. You know, as they say, Lord willing, and the creek don't rise.
Oh, there you go. Okay. That answers my question. I would love that. I would absolutely love that. Who was the first person that said you would be ideal as the editor of Railroad Model Craftsman? Do you remember?
You, of course, Lionel.
At Pillar 68.
So I have two short stories, and they embarrass me. I haven't told anyone these stories. They embarrass me. I'm going to share them because it's the 90th anniversary. 20 years ago, I'm visiting my good friend Tom Rohatch. We co-founded the RIT Model Railroad Club together. And we were both in college, and I came home with him for one of the breaks. And we were kind of both from the Hudson Valley, so it wasn't like I was going across the country to visit him. But he's a model railroader. His dad's a model railroader. I was hanging out with him for the weekend. We're having an op session down in the basement, and we're just shooting, you know, the bull and just switching cars and having an op session there. But they had a nice basement layout. It was small, but like there was a lot of operation. There was a yard, and there was customers and car cards and waybills. And it was very relaxed and nice, and it was fun. And his dad is also, his dad's Tom Sr. So I had Tom and Tom. We're just hanging out in the living room after the operating session with just us. And I showed him an article I wrote. I published some article. It's called One Car or 100. It was a track plan based on a short line called the Ontario Central. It's a Rochester area short line. And it had just come out, and he saw it, and he's like, and we were just talking about stuff for hours. And he's just like, man, you're so good at this. You should be editor. You should work for this magazine. And I'm like, and I just kind of like laughed. And I'm just kind of like, oh, well, I don't know. You know, it's also, I was like 21. Like, I didn't know like what life was. Fast forward, you know, a few years later, and I'm doing work for freelance work for Carstens, drawing track plans, drawing drawings, doing articles, whatever they need. And just hanging out. I made a trip down to the office. I'd go down to the office like every few months or so just to say hi and hang out and get lunch and whatever. I'm hanging out in the office with Chris D'Amato and Jim Ankrum, and we're just, you know, shooting the bull about something. And, you know, Chris kind of looked at me sheepishly, and he's just kind of like, you know, we talk about like who's gonna carry the torch in the next generation, and you know, your name comes up a lot as someone who could be editor someday. And he said it like real quiet, and he kind of like was just kind of, well, it was just kind of like, I don't know. And I thought it was, I was super flattered he was saying it. But again, like when you're like 25, you don't know where your life is going. And I can't remember if I was even between jobs at that point or what my life was doing, but I was super flattered. But I'm like, I don't even see a way. You don't see your life's path. You know, you think you know what you want to do, but, and you guys, I've told the story. You guys are probably tired of hearing it, but you know, one thing leads to another. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, plop, plop, here I am in the editor's chair. And it's just, it's bizarre. I pinch myself every day. I have the best job in the world. I'm still working on Railfan. That's the best job in the world. Kevin and Nadine are the best bosses in the world. I mean, it's, honestly, I can't say enough. I'm really grateful for where I am, but I can't do what I do without the support of the industry, without support of the readers. This magazine, this is not the Otto Vondrak magazine. This is Railroad Model Craftsman. It's for the readers. It's for you. And if we're not doing a good job, I'm going to hear about it because the content is going to stop coming in. The advertising is going to stop coming in.
I feel like when you said it's for you, you were looking directly at me.
It is actually specifically, I meant to tell you, Lionel, the next issue, it says this issue's for Lionel in like 72 point type on the cover.
You know, when you said, you'd go to the offices every couple of months, or I used to do that when I was writing my column at MR, when I felt like I was part of the team, and I would go fairly regularly to the offices in Milwaukee. And I can always remember with great fondness what Andy Sprandio would always say to me when I got there.
Get out, you bum. What are you doing here?
Yeah, it was, what are you doing here?
Who stamped your visa? Literally.
Yeah. Again, you're here. What do you want?
Security. Security.
Yeah. Security. Yeah. Yeah.
It was. I've got a. I guess maybe a final question. For
this Otto is the final question.
Okay. It's the final question.
There you go. You've got this great 90th anniversary issue put together with some looking back and all that good stuff. You got anything else planned to celebrate your 90th anniversary?
Why, I'm glad you asked. Yes, we do. As you know, Railroad Model Craftsman has a very long tradition of putting out commemorative boxcars and passenger cars.
Oh,
yes, they do.
Yep.
And I'm very excited to announce, you'll see the advertisements in the March issue. We've partnered with Scale Trains, and they're producing a 40-foot PS1 boxcar with special commemorative graphics designed by yours truly.
Oh, that, I bet you that'll sell well.
What's the MRS on that?
I don't have it in front of me. I want to say it's going to be $30 retail. Advertisements will be out in the March issue. Sometimes things change between what I send out and what gets in print, but that's all the head office. But it's going to be around $30. We want to keep it moderate. And this is going to be it's a very nice molded car, crisp graphics, metal trucks, metal wheels, knuckle couplers. And it's a nice, everyone's like, oh, another 40-foot box car. Yeah, You know why? 40-foot boxcars are cool. That's why.
That's right. They are cool. 40-foot
boxcars have been around a lot longer than the other ones.
And they are cool.
They are cool. And what I did specifically on this car, I kind of modeled this car as a 70s car. So it's a 40-foot boxcar, but it actually has, like, you know, COTS stencils. And, you know, it's kind of like a late era. I tried to straddle the line between making a fun commemorative car, but also something you wouldn't be embarrassed to, like, throw on a freight train. You know, like, right. you could just weather this car and it just, you know, roll on your freight train and no one would even give a second look. I want to stand out but blend in.
So where would somebody?
You say that'll be announced in the March issue? You say
The ads will be in our March issue, and I'm sure it'll be listed on our bookstore. Hopefully by the time this podcast is made live.
Perfect. Excellent. But you know what? Yeah. Speaking of boxcars and freight cars, you know where I always buy my freight cars? From Rapido.
Where do you buy your freight cars from, Lionel?
I buy all my freight cars from Rapido Trains.
Your fast track to model railroading fun.
I love it. That was nice. That was good. That was natural.
Hey, Kelly, can you give out our email address?
Yes, I can give out our email address. Our email address is modelerslife@gmail.com. That's modelers with one L like Midland, not two L's like Allegheny.
Ooh.
Smooth.
Wow. Holy.
I was looking for L's and I was going to do Alan, but his last name's got three L's, so I couldn't even guess.
So many L's and they always go in the wrong place.
Yeah, one L
ask
like
me how I know.
One L like Midland, not two L's like Allegheny. Ooh, yeah. Nice. That's one of
Thank
your
you,
best ones. That's one of your
thank
best.
Thank you, Otto, because you said the name, and I go, oh, there it is.
Perfect.
That's like one of your best ever.
But I want to reiterate that the fact that Otto, you're on that list, and you're on that list for a reason, and don't sell yourself short on that. You're rising up to the same level as those guys have been. So.
Hey, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Do you have a question, Kelly?
Oh, when are you coming out with the commuter book?
Oh, there you are.
Yes.
I forgot about that.
Commuter book is probably going to be another year or two out. I did just put another book out to press. Again, you should see the advertisements in the March issue. One of our frequent contributors to Craftsman Workshop is George Dutka.
Oh, yes.
And we just put together a new title. You're hearing it first. Model Railroading with George Dutka.
Oh, okay.
Cool. And it's
who's that with?
What's that?
I say, who's that with?
Published by our fine friends at White River Productions.
There you go. George is an excellent columnist, yeah, or articleist, whatever you want to call him. And
he's great. And what we did was it's a mix of some older content that's previously published, but it's the majority of it is actually new content that he wrote specifically for this book. And it's a lot of things. It's scenery, it's weathering, it's kit bashing, it's detailing, and then we also take a little tour of his layout at the end. So it's nice. It's a nice project idea book. It's for all skill levels. Just his stories are fun to read, and his photography is really good, and I think you'll enjoy it. So again, look for that, Model Railroading with George Dutka, and you'll see it on our bookstore, and you'll see it advertised in the March issue.
We should get George on the podcast.
We should.
George would be great. Yeah, I think you'd enjoy talking with him. He's been a great proponent of the hobby in his own right. He's a member of the Niagara Frontier Region.
Yep.
NMRA, which I was until recently when they just redrew the lines. Now I'm back in the NER, which is what I was in, but I lived back in New York. Now I'm in the Northeastern region, but no, one of the great things that George does is the NFR would sponsor a Craftsman's Corner at a lot of local and regional train shows where you just had like three or four guys sitting at a table building models, and you just come up and ask them questions like, hey, what are you working on?
Yeah. They used to go over to Train Fest every year.
Yeah, you see him at Train Fest. And, mm-hmm. But anyway, no, George is great, and we're really excited to partner with him. And I think you'll enjoy this book. The commuter book, you know, we're talking about revisiting the Consider the Commuter series. It's something that's near and dear to my heart. You know, it's kind of a project layout that I shepherded through the process here, and I'd like to release it as a book. It's not as I could just take all the articles as they ran and just repackage it as a book. Yeah. There are certain things I want to revisit, things we ran out of space for. You know, the magazine format, sometimes you have a lot of room, sometimes it's constricting. But I want to do more than just re-release those articles as a book. So there's some production issues where our marketing boss, George Riley, he built some of the modules. I built some of the modules. I would need to go fetch his modules and reconstruct some of them so that we could redo some of the principal photography from the book, for example, you know.
Are you looking for more prototype stuff to throw in there?
There's probably some more prototype. You know, like we briefly touched on prototype. You know, I grew up in the New York metropolitan area, so commuter trains are near and dear to my heart. Yeah. But commuter trains, you find them all across the country. It's not just rush hour every 20 minute service in New York. There's commuter trains all across the country, and not just today. There's historically commuter trains everywhere.
Yes.
You can adapt it to almost any scenario. And that was one of the articles I showed. Look, just by swapping out the equipment and the vehicles, you can change eras, you can change locations, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So it's like, I don't want people to think that that's a pigeonhole thing. But again, there's things I want to expand on. So it's not ready to just plop into a book and just reprint. I don't want to just do that. So,
yeah. Cause I was thinking, if you're looking in prototype, there's this guy named Dave Abley's knows a little bit about commuter railroad.
Oh yeah.
I've heard of this guy, Dave Abley's, works for Jersey Transit, I think.
Yeah.
He's all right.
He's all right. He's kind of a quiet guy. He likes to stick to himself and, you know, keep to himself, but you know, he might know a little bit about it.
I'm sure we'll circle him in somehow.
Yeah. Do you think there's commuter trains in Loop City, Nebraska?
If not, I could show you how to add them.
You know, you're stretching this out. You're doing. You're going to get charged by the minute here soon.
Yeah. I put another quarter in the meter. We're good.
All right. We've had our email address. One of the best Kelly's ever done. Yes. If you didn't catch the email address and you're dying to send us email, if you just go to our website, amodelerslife.com, and scroll down a little bit and click on the picture of the moderately agitated mail boy in a particularly agitated state, all you got to do is click on his picture, and the email is the address is automatically comes up, and you just got to fill in your text, and you're ready to go and send that off to us.
And we'd love to get your email.
Yeah. And also, while you're at amodelerslife.com, which is sponsored by Rapido Trains,
your fast track to model railroading fun,
you can go to the Patreon. If you like this show,
who wouldn't like this show?
That's absolutely full of chock full of information, history. Who wouldn't like it? You can also click on the Patreon app, and for just a few cents a day, you too can have twice as much podcasting every week. And it's
every week?
Every single week. Instead of having one podcast, you'll have two podcasts.
Holy moly. What a deal.
I know. You'll be able to drive to work back and forth like 2 or 3 days and have something to listen to.
Wow.
And finally, Otto. I was thinking of that today. I was listening to a show we re-recorded, and I couldn't remember somebody's name who was sitting right across the table from me. And I was thinking, and now I'm starting to hear how everybody's starting to pick up that, okay, Lionel's getting older. We need to fill in the gaps.
Lionel can't see the cue cards.
Yeah,
right. Got to prompt him.
He's he doesn't. So, Otto, have you ever wanted a T-shirt with a hot dog on it?
You know, not until this very moment.
Well, have we got news for you. If you go to Midwest Model Railroad, and their URL is midwestmodelrr.com, and you scroll across the menu bar to Other. Do I sound Other?
Yes. And you sound miffed on that.
Yeah. And you click on Other. The first thing you'll see is AML merchandise. And you click on that. And boom, you're in a wonderland of AML merchandise, hats, hoodies, T-shirts, whatever you could possibly need. And in there, there's a t-shirt with a hot dog on it.
Yeah. And you know some Otto, that t-shirt would look great on you when you're visiting the various Rochester bars.
Yeah.
Indeed, indeed. I could see it now. I can picture it. Yeah.
Yeah. Imagine you're sitting in a bar wearing a t-shirt with a hot dog on it, and you're sitting with your friend, and you know what? I'm going to dump my beer on his phone.
I get that a lot. Yeah. Yeah.
I was so glad it still worked after that. Your face. Yeah. I felt bad for you. I still haven't figured out if you were doing it on purpose or by accident. And when I do, boy. We were bar hopping and we were having fun.
It was a good time.
It was a good time. That's it. That's it.
There we go.
And we're done. We're finished.
Thank you, Otto. Thank you.
Yeah, thank
you. Thank you, guys.
Yeah. Thanks for all your questions, Kelly. That was great.
I like the part where Kelly asked a question.
Yeah.
Dear sirs, listening to the Otto Vondrak 90th anniversary, I really like the part where Kelly asked a question. It was the greatest.
I don't know if anybody notices it, but when there's a guest on there that's riveting, I guess, I don't know if that's the right word or not, but I tend to lose focus where I'm at. I don't fall asleep. I lose focus on asking questions, and I'm listening to what the guest is saying.
Oh. You're right. So you could at least get us a drink or something.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah, we want you to be involved.
I know.
All right. Otto, are you ready?
I'm ready.
So remember, a Modeler's Life podcast is considered marginally adequate by 6 out of 10
bar hoppers.
Modeler's Life is sponsored by Because I Love Sushi, with 7 convenient locations in the greater Busted Knuckle area.
It's another Lincoln Homer.
Nice. Oh, bar hoppers. Nice. I'm hoping if they ever do a TV movie of the week featuring us about me talking to you about being the editor of Railroad Model Craftsman, and we get to the big scene where we're standing by Pillar 68, I imagine it to be kind of, kind of a little smoky, a little foggy, a little mysterious. You know,
music rising.
Yeah, dramatic music rising. Yeah.
Backlit so you're silhouetted against the fog in the background.
Yeah, exactly.
I can see it now. It'll be
a searchlight.
It'll be on Netflix. It'll be a 6-part series, Craftsman, the Otto Vondrak story.
Yeah, I was thinking more Craftsman, Lionel discovers a star.
That makes more sense.
Yeah.
I think that's more marketable.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I'm going to have top billing.